Well, everybody, welcome to the Sunset Safari here with Wild Earth. My name is James Hendry. I'm slightly flustered, of course, because Brent was supposed to start, and I think he either burnt his vehicle to the ground, or perhaps there's just no signal. My name is James Hendry. Like I say, on camera today we have Tebs, who is draped in a wet towel because it is very warm still in the low veld, despite the fact that we have now passed the summer solstice. I expect the weather to become even hotter. We are heading in a due westerly direction, hoping to find a leopard that was seen this morning, a male leopard called Tingana, who many of you will know, a 9-year-old male, magnificent fellow, and he's in the far west of his territory now, so we'll see if we can go and find him. Brent is knocking about somewhere off to the east there on Djuma. Exactly what he's managed to do to his car, I'm not really sure. Anyway, he will be knocking about there. There were some wild dog tracks around this morning, so I'm sure he's going to try and look for them. He's being filmed by the inimitable drone commander Andrew Francis, and in the final control for her last evening here is Nikki Austin, and with her Louise Pavide. Now, it's just Louise, at least just Nikki. Louise is absconded as well. There's lots of absconding going on around these parts these days, which is Christmas, I suppose. You are on a live safari, which is why, of course, the sound is not quite as it would be on an edited show. That shouldn't have happened. And so we'd like to hear from you. Anything you'd like to tell us, hashtag Safari Live, or questions at WildEarthTV if you're on the email. Anything you want to know about the area we're in, the animals we see, some of the trees we go past, an insect perhaps that you'd like to see. That's the general idea here. So that's what we're going to be doing. We're going to be heading east. Here we go. Right, now I did get a question coming through there. Unfortunately, the microphone detached, at least the earpiece detached itself, so we'll get it again. It's from B. Now, B. Wilson, you are obviously with us on the Sunrise Drive, and we had to cut it short by about half an hour because of the rain, and you want to know how much rain we got, and did we get much rain? B. Wilson, we got very little rain. There was enough to sort of stop us, but it went on for about 15 or 20 minutes, and then it kind of stopped and petered out. The sun came back out again, and the drought conditions persist, I'm afraid. So that's what's going on here at the moment. You can see, if you look around, certainly if you look down the road there, there is no puddle, there is no kind of moisture, and it looks almost like a winter road. That sort of cap that comes with the wetness has gone. So, not much rain. And apparently we were chatting to a chap today, an ecologist in the area, and he reckons that this El Nino system that we have is basically holding the water off the coast. And then in about February, it'll move across, and we should get a major dumping of rain in February time, which will not, it's kind of a bit late for the growth season, but it will, it's the kind of thing that this ecology is used to. So although it might look a bit dry and, by then it might be a bit depressing. I don't think it will, but it might be. Certainly it's nothing. The animals and plants and other creatures of this area have not had to deal with for millennia, so don't worry about that. So Arathusa is the little property to the west of Djuma, and we don't come here that often. We do spend some time here, so it is slightly terra incognito. Sent through a very detailed question. It's a nice one. While we're driving along, hoping to find Tingana possibly lurking in a tree with an impala for supper. Ashley, your friend has just visited the Kruger up near the Punda Maria area, saw two antelope or two animals there with malformed horns, one an impala and one a buffalo. And you want to know why this is. Is it some kind of genetic anomaly? Is it inbreeding? Is it just fluke? What is it? Ashley, it's basically just fluke. It's a sort of a genetic anomaly that occurs. I don't think inbreeding will have anything to do with it. It's like having square teeth. Some are born with straight teeth and some are simply not born with straight teeth. And while we have the facility to use orthodontists and that sort of thing, of course the animals don't. And so their horns sometimes grow a little squat, so do their teeth. There's an elephant around here with a tusk that is totally recurved and comes back. Some grow out like that, and that's all it is. I think it's pure coincidence that they were both found up near Punda Maria. I suppose it is possible that the parents of those malformed animals, well, I mean, they're hardly malformed, but those with sort of strange horns, it's possible that there was some kind of nutritional stress maybe when they were born, maybe why they were in the area together, but you'd expect there to be more than one individual from both species to have been affected if that was the case. Nice question. Thank you, Ashley. So we're now on a drainage line called the Marikeni, which is the major drainage line that runs through Arathusa. Now, Cat in Florida and Smart Redhead very kindly wanted to know what had befallen my beautiful set of binoculars, last used by Field Marshal Erwin Rommel at the Battle of Tobruk in the Second World War. Not really, but that's what they looked like. And I left them actually at the Pickney Nest yesterday when we walked there. Andrew and I walked there in the morning and I sort of lay down to investigate the thing, left my binoculars there, and I drove back in the morning while I was on the tracking expedition, and there they were, sitting unmolested next to the nest. So there they are. They're, as Scott said yesterday, he wasn't tremendously sympathetic because they're a particularly poor example of binoculars, but you see, when you leave them around the place like I tend to, spending excessive amounts of money on quality glass, well, I'm just not convinced it's worth it. And spend a quite fantabulous amount of money on binoculars if you want to. Hello, Noah. You say you're about to drive to Kansas City and it's going to take you 9 hours. I assume, therefore, that you're on the East Coast somewhere. I'd be very interested to know what's in Kansas City for you to go to. I didn't know it was a sort of holiday destination. So anyway, enjoy your trip, but you say you're having 3 hours of safari before you go. Well, good stuff. It's a pity you can't sort of listen to us in the car. I wouldn't suggest you watch us in the car, though. Very well watching us in business meetings, not so much in the car. Good luck for your drive, and wherever you're going, I hope it's fun. And Regan, you are in London, and you seem to be a new viewer. This is marvelous news. Regan, you want to know what time safari starts. Regan, safari starts at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and in the morning is at 5 o'clock, and so where you are, that's 2 hours behind. So if you're really safari mad, you can get up at 3 o'clock in the morning and watch us start, and then in the afternoon, you have your lunch at work, go into a meeting, and just have the... Ooh, look, little Franklins. Little baby Franklins. These are very skilled parents to have raised so many from their clutch. Little crested Franklins. So Regan will start at 2 o'clock for you in the afternoon. That will change as the season progresses, but for the next foreseeable future, that's what it'll be. these are little crested Franklins, and I say they're very good parents because they see, I think they only lay three or four eggs, and they seem to have all four little babies still with them. Marvelous. The adults, of course, can be fairly, well, they're not. I mean, calling them poor parents is a bit mean. Very difficult to be a ground-dwelling bird and raise babies when your nest is on the ground and your babies are not safe in a tree somewhere in the little nest. Right, we're going to carry along here, see what we can see. I just want to tell you two birds that I can hear. I can hear a tawny-flanked prinier there going toop, 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 toop. Naturally, not anymore. It went, and then there's the grey-headed bushrike, a beautiful coloured bird, green and yellow and orange, and with a grey head, of course. And the grey-headed bushrike has a beautiful, soft, lilting call. I'll just try and find you a picture of the grey-headed bushrike. There he is. Delightful fellow, very big bird. And while he is very beautiful, he's not particularly nice to other birds. He's a shrike, of course, so he's a meat eater. And you can see all the shrikes have got that little tooth. You might just be able to see it in front of my nail there. All of the shrikes have got a little tooth in the front of their beaks that they use to eat. He will eat chicks, nestlings out of nests. He'll eat reptiles. And there goes the woodland kingfisher above us. Right. There's never any shortage of him when you want him to call. Okay, let's carry on. Top, you want to know what the name of the property we're on now is. It is west of Djuma, like you say. It's not Chitwa Chitwa. Chitwa Chitwa is well to the south of Djuma. This is called Arathusa, or if you say it with proper pronunciation, Arathusa. And it means, apparently, Arathusa means let's help each other in the language called Pedi. Tebs, do you have any knowledge of Pedi? Is it the same in Tswana? Same. Yes. Tusa to help. Okay. Right, let's head across to Brent Leo Smith. He's managed to put the fire out on his car, and he'll say hello to you and tell his plans. We'll carry on looking for the leopard. See you soon.
Welcome to the Rust Bucket, aka Rusty. Andrew has managed, and Tebs have managed to put together some concoction that is enabling you to hear me and see me. Fortunately for me, I am not involved in such things. My name is Brent Leo Smith. I have the techno wizard, well, new techno wizard, Andrew Francis, who didn't even know he had it in him till today. And we are still in search of those wild dogs. They're literally tracks across the whole of Djuma. And hopefully we're going to find them. For those of you, this is Safari Live. We're taking you on an actual live game drive through the African bushveld. At the moment, I'm traveling in the southeastern corner of Djuma Private Game Reserve. I know James is heading off to follow up a leopard to the west of us in Arathusa. Believe it or not, I'm... Whoa! Before I carry on babbling, let's go see what James has found.
Look at that, everybody. Tim's just spotted a scrub hare. We so seldom see them during the day because they're so very well hidden. And this little chap thinks he's very well hidden. He thinks we can't see him. Look at his red eyes. That's the most amazing thing to me. A red tinged eye. Look at the little nose going. Isn't he sweet? It might be a she. they are sort of, you know, this is the sort of peak birthing time for them. So it's quite possible that she's a she. And I don't know if there isn't a little one maybe lying around there, and that's why she isn't lying in the bush itself. They have two little babies, I think, normally, called leverets. And they, unlike rabbits, are born precocial, a bit like ground-dwelling birds. They don't have the safety of a burrow like a rabbit does, and so they must be born able to run almost immediately. And so a hare's baby is much less helpless than a rabbit's baby. Alrighty, let's head back to Brent. We're going to carry on down here looking for the leopard, and I'll see you soon.
Fantastic to see one of the more nocturnal species still during the day. And as you were sitting with James, Andrew and I were discussing the last time we saw a scrub hare, and it was disemboweled and dismembered by the pack of wild dogs we're currently searching for. And incredibly, it had two, not one, but two almost fully developed fetuses inside that also became a snack for the wild dog puppies. It is a blistery afternoon after a lovely cool morning. It was nice to get a bit of a respite from the heat this morning, even though a little bit of hard drizzle chased us undercover, but we're back with a vengeance, the sunset safari. We've got a request from a Southern Belle, Jacqueline in Savannah, Georgia. Oh. Would like to know if we're going to see a giant land snail. She thinks it'd be a cool critter to see. Are they around at the moment? They are, Jacqueline. This is the time of the year to see them, but today is not the day, I'm afraid. With this blistering heat, what they'll do is they'll find a nice sort of shady protected spot, and they'll actually close up and form a sort of protective mucous membrane around themselves until it's a bit more wet. So this morning would have been a good time during the drizzle, but we didn't spot any. And I have spotted an old boy. Let's just try and figure where we can see him from. I can't see any others around. It looks like he's flying solo today. That's an old buffalo bull. Apologize, I do have open game drive comms today. Oh, Andrew, hunting.
Hunting what?
Oh, yes. One of my favorite little birds. It just looked like he grabbed a spider out of its web. There's a white crowned helmet shy. See, I like to keep Andrew on his toes.
I only see a drongo.
No, Andrew. Above, okay. There we go. There's two of them there. Let me go forward a little bit. Oh, let's see if we can get a nice. Oh, no, don't fly away. Andrew, you chased them. Because you didn't recognize their beauty fast enough, Andrew. You still got them? White helmet shrikes. One of my favorite little birds. Often referred to as the Seven Sisters, due to the fact they are generally in flocks of seven, and they seem to be testing Andrew's camera skills today. But hopefully we'll get a nicer closer view. That old buffalo bull is still sitting there, wondering what the fuss is about a few fluttering birds. He's found himself a nice shady spot to chew the cud. fast asleep. So normally they are in little bachelor groups. This guy's by himself, which does make him a little bit more vulnerable to predation by lions. And we'll leave him to his afternoon siesta and see if we can try to figure out what happened to these wild dogs. Seems like RJM, who was with us on the sunrise safari, is with us again on the sunset safari. Welcome back, RJ. Great to have you here again. RJ goes, what is a giant land snail? Well, it's a snail, RJ. No, I'm just kidding. It's a snail, but it's massive. I mean, some of their shells can be sort of this big. And guess what? They are carnivorous. So they feed off other snails and other bits of decaying animal matter, or specifically insects. So very interesting. And hopefully, if you keep watching RJM, you'll get to see one. Who's watching on YouTube as well, says she's got a friend who's got giant African land snails as a pet. That is a first for me. I've never heard of anyone having a land snail as a pet. I know my gran used to encourage them in her garden to eat the snails that were attacking her roses. New viewers out there, there has been probably a very kind warning from Shell, who's in Motor City, Detroit. Did you see them? I heard them.
They've disappeared.
Shell is warned, if I do find wild dogs, you guys will just have to hang on, because I drive like a madman or a man possessed, and I'll speak quite loudly and quite quickly, and I get very, very excited. I mean, I'm excited most of the time. It just sort of goes up a few gears when I see wild dogs. I sort of start behaving like a wild dog, which was actually my nickname when I lived in Tanzania. My Swahili nickname was Mbamwitu, which is wild dog, because I used to get so excited when I saw them, as well as that I had a lot of energy like a wild dog, and I was always running around camp, making sure everyone was working and doing whatever had to be done during the day. Area. There was tracks everywhere, all over Djuma this morning, and I'm hoping I don't find any tracks crossing out. But while I do that, let's just go have a look at what Commander Bond, the Christmas elf, is up to.
Ed, we are driving very slowly now into the west. I believe Brent Leo Smith just called me a Christmas elf. I'm going to have to think of a suitable retort. A Christmas elf, indeed. It's quite amusing, Brent. Right, there we go. We've got not a leopard, I'm afraid, but we've got two vultures up there, which is quite nice. Two white-backed vultures sitting in a tree there. And I believe we've had a request for a giant land snail. Well, after rain, little bit of rain that we've had, it's not uncommon to find a giant land snail, so I will certainly keep an eye out for a giant land snail. Now, while we're driving along, Tingana was around this area this morning, and I can't get quite an update as to exactly where he was, because the radios are in a state of disrepair. Trying to, you know, operate it or fix a radio is a bit like trying to master black magic. It's not particularly easy. And there are no sort of studies that seem to help it. Anyway, we're going to drive around this general area. It's nice to explore a new area. I've been into this area once or twice, but it's really nice to kind of see it again. So that's the general plan. Those are white-backed vultures, one of five vulture species that we get here, and I think they're probably sitting on a nest. I don't think they're there because they've seen something dead. They do when they're sort of just roosting, or if they're looking at a kill, or if they're around a kill site, there'll normally be more than two of them, and they will normally be sitting in a dead tree because it offers a much more impeded view, unimpeded view, of course, than those leafy trees. So then they nest in those sort of the tops of the leafy trees, and that particular tree is called a torchwood or green thorn. So Matty, your age is just 9, and you've been asking for 2 weeks apparently about vultures. Well, there they are. And I'll tell you what, you can look up the other ones. We get the lappet-faced vulture, which is an enormous vulture with a kind of pinky, ugly head. Very beautiful once you get used to them. The white-headed vulture, which I think is the prettiest one that we've got. Then we've got the hooded vulture, and we've also got, what's the other one? The Cape vulture that comes in off the cliffs. Right. Big birds. Let's go back to Mr. Spaghetti, Brent Leo Smith, or String Bean. He can be your Christmas String Bean. That will be Brent Leo Smith, and he's sitting with some wattled starlings. We'll carry on along here.
So, on our search for the African wild dog, we've just come across a displaying male wattled starling, and he's trying to impress the girls. It is their breeding season, so those impressive features and colors around his head, that black and yellow wattles and warts and growths, will not be there during the dry season. So he grows those to impress the girls, and he was doing a little bit of song and dance. And I don't see many girls who he's trying to impress. So, oh, now he looks like he's got a little bit camera shy. But we're going to give Andrew another chance to save himself with white helmet shrikes who I've just seen fly ahead of us. And this is it, Andrew. This is the pressure is now on you to find the bird. So they've just flown to here. And if they have flown off, I will forgive you. There they are. Oh, they're flying. Okay. You are forgiven. Oh. There we go. It's not the best view of them, but it is those white helmet shrikes again. And hopefully we will get a better view. They are stunning birds. And I think we should carry on to go see what the Christmas elf is up to. And Pat in Toronto agrees that James would make a very good Christmas elf. Now, the reason I call James the Christmas elf is that I haven't seen a grown man with so much excitement for Christmas. And we got our big Christmas food order, which we will be eating with great delight. And on the order was Christmas pudding. Unfortunately, all the Christmas pudding in Hoedspruit was sold out. And this morning, he was absolutely distraught that we could only have mince pies and no Christmas pudding. And I think you should tease him a little bit about that. So let's go have a look what the Christmas elf is up to now.
Yes, well, I was very, very angry about that Christmas pudding because our inestimable supplier of purveyor of foods, mostly not so fine, called Pick and Pay, failed to send a Christmas pudding. They sent two instant puddings, one chocolate and one butterscotch. Now, I don't know if you've ever been subjected to trying to eat an instant pudding. It's like eating sort of sugary gloop of indeterminate flavor, and it certainly doesn't come close to replicating the magnificence of a good Christmas pudding as cooked by my great aunt Jill, which of course I will not be eating this year because I'm over here. And so I was rather hoping to replicate the tradition of walking into the room with the Christmas pudding ablaze to the tune of some bagpipes, perhaps. And that, of course, is going to be difficult because you can't really set an instant chocolate pudding ablaze. Well, you can, and you probably should, but you can't then eat it afterwards. Pat in Toronto, you think I would make a cute Christmas elf. Well, I suppose that's a compliment. I'm going to take it. Thank you, Pat. Hibbs, I think you'd also be quite a good Christmas elf, don't you? Two Christmas elves. We're not very big, either of us. To know about our Christmas dinner and who's going to be there and what it will be like. Well, until very recently, Brent Leo Smith was going to be there, but I've now disinvited him because he's called me an elf. So he will be having Christmas on his own in the Mulwati drainage line with a bread roll and a piece of cheese, if he's lucky. The rest of us are going to be having ham and roast chicken. This will be prepared by... Oh, look at the beautiful grey-hooded kingfisher. This is stunning. Now, Mike, you needed a grey... There. You see it there, Tibbs? Mike, in Florida, I believe you wanted a grey-headed kingfisher for your list to hit 200. That is a grey-headed kingfisher. And very distinct from any of the other halcyon kingfishers. If you look at the blue, well, I don't know if you can see the blue on the wing there. You might be able to see the blue. It's not that halcyon blue colour. It's a much more navy, purplish blue. That's my first one of the season. Scott Dyson, of course, has seen 700 of them. But they're not very common. And he's very hot, as is everything else very hot, including the buffalo, which I failed to notice when we stopped here. But let's just look at this little kingfisher a bit longer and savor the sight. So Mike in Florida, I believe this will take your list, your Wild Earth bird list, to 200. That's truly impressive. I think you'll find that there are probably only sort of 230 regular resident species of bird that you could sort of get often here, and maybe up to 280 or so with rare vagrants. So 200 is very, very good. Beautiful bird. Right, now, Tebs, what I'm going to ask you to do is swing across to the pan over there, and you can see there's a buffalo staring at us, wondering what on earth we've stopped for. And that is a very old fellow, that. You can see his horns are very mangled. And they're kind of, that keratin sheath on the top of them seems to be wearing very thin. And they're blunt on the end. Yeah, I think he must try and find some friends he can hang about with. And failing that, he needs to avoid being around any form of lion. Right, we're now at a spot called Second Windmill. Now, it's called Second Windmill, of course, because there is a windmill over there. And that windmill is it's not so much a mill as a pump. Apparently, it's pumping water, I think, into the pan where the beefy buffalo is lying in the mud. And this is the kind of far extremity, as far west as we can come. So we're on the far western boundary of Arathusa. Further west of this, we will be trespassing, which will result, of course, in arrest, which will be very unpleasant because then I will also be eating bread and cheese for Christmas like Brent Leo Smith. Right, I'm going to sneak slightly forward and hope that this kingfisher lets us look at him. A bit closer look. Ooh, don't fly. Spectacular. This is a wonderful view of a rare bird, people. Isn't he great? Look at the colour on his beak. Luminous orange, fluorescent. Then a question about what sound they make. Oh, you can see that purple there. So it's not even navy blue. I mean, it's basically purple. And I'll try and play the call for you. I'll find the bird app and play the call. King? No, not shrike. Beautiful afternoon now. All right, here we go. This is what he sounds like, everyone. Come on. Nope. I don't know that he has a sound. Here we go. Sing, bird. There we go. Here we go. Look at him reacting. He's very confused. There, he's calling. That's him calling. I'm just going to keep playing and see if he doesn't come back here. He's flown off into a tree there, Ted, but he's very far away. I think he'll come back. Here he comes. No, he's flown away. He's taken flight. Come on, bird, come and defend your territory. There's an intruder. Anyway, that's the grey hooded kingfisher. I don't want to abuse him too much. Let's leave him be. That was very cool. You can hear him going now. I wouldn't have known that call, actually. He's very cross. Let's get out of here before he realizes that we've followed him. Another beefalo over there. There he is. I'm glad this old fellow that we first saw has got a friend. Gaza Arsenal. Just amazing Twitter handles that we get here. Gaza Arsenal, you say that the grey-hooded kingfisher puts you at 20. Well, I'm very glad it's put you at 20. It's always good to get the rare ones first and try and get the others a bit later. But that's a good one to have at number 20. Here comes an Arathusa ranger, and with any luck, they will be able to tell us where this recalcitrant leopard was last found, because it really would be very good to see him, and the radios are not in a functional state. Hello, Randall on YouTube. You want to know about kingfishers and why they're called kingfishers? Well, a lot of them actually eat fish. I'm just going to ask a question of this fellow quickly, and we'll head across to Brent, and I will explain the kingfisher thing just now.
Cheetah planes. Sorry about that, folks. I was on the Gam Drive radio, and I just wanted to show you. Look at that. That is all that is left of the Buffalo's Hook Dam. Tiny, tiny bit of water. Now, there's still a lot of moisture and mud underneath there, but I think the test will be to see if by New Year, we're going to be able to walk across it. I think I should challenge James. Not just yet, I think we would get very, very muddy now. But at some point in the near future, who will be the first person to walk across the sun-baked Buffalo's Hook Dam? It is very hot. So, let's see what else we can find. Thank you. we are very fortunately garnering a lot of new support and new viewers. And one of those is David Russell. Welcome, David. And David would like to know, when did this wonderful show start? David, I know it was discussed on the Sunrise Safari, but... Oh, hello, little guys. As far as I know, the first show was in April 2007. With only a maximum of 80 people being able to watch the show. Obviously, times have changed, and we're sitting here with a nice little group of vervet monkeys. And they always look guilty, like they've just done something wrong or they're about to do something wrong. And also, I haven't played this game for a while, and I want to see who out there is on top of their old animal collective nouns. What is the original colonial collective noun for a group of monkeys? It's quite a strange one, I do warn you. And you can send your answers through on questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. What is the original colonial collective noun for a group of monkeys? What I think they're probably doing in this knobthorn tree is there might be some very new little seed pods coming out, which will be quite a delicacy for a little vervet. Andrew, do you need me to move anywhere? Are you happy? Now, this is a good sign for us. Monkeys are incredible, have incredible eyesight and incredibly good at spotting predators. So, I know if I hear any monkey alarm calling around Biffleshook Dam, I know which area they're in, and that could be a good sign. If there are leopard in the area, the monkeys spot them quite quickly. Okay, little monks. Keep a lookout for a leopard for us. And seems like the Christmas elf's Christmas has come early. Let's see what he's got.
Well, I don't know what Christmas coming early, but certainly a early pre-Christmas present. Wonderful to see this leopard. I haven't seen him for some time. In fact, I don't think any of us have seen him since he went down into the warthog's burrow and retrieved a little sort of tennis ball sized piglet alive and during Big Cat Week. So he saved his best performance of the year for when it really counted. He's eaten something far more substantial than a warthog piglet now. You can see his belly is very, very full. And he's had a good meal. He's now panting because it's hot and because he's trying to digest that meal as fast as possible. Wonderful. So just to reiterate, if you just joined us, this is Tingana, a 9-year-old male leopard. And he's a good-sized male leopard. He's not the biggest. That would be the Anderson male around here. Who's a enormous leopard. He's probably about 10 or 20% larger than Tingana. But Tingana's about an average-sized male leopard for this area. Magnificent creature fellow. And Maggie, I believe you're in Western Australia. You say you've had a tough time. Your cat's been ill this week. And you were hoping for a leopard to make you feel better. Well, I hope this will make you feel better. There's Tingana. He's not ill at all. He looks to be in fine fettle. And the last time I saw him, actually, he had a nasty limp. I think as a result of some very vigorous mating that he and Karula were doing. And that seems to have healed quite nicely. If he's hunting, I haven't seen him walk, but if he's hunting so successfully, it certainly can't be affecting him at all. Oh, look at him. There he goes. And just if you are a new viewer, remember this is a completely live safari experience. What you're seeing now is reaching you very marginally delayed by about maybe 5 seconds. After we're seeing it, you're seeing the same thing. So it is completely live in high definition out of the Kruger National Park or the western fringes thereof. And that is a magnificent male leopard, to my mind, the iconic cat of Africa.
are the most powerful cats.
He is, of course, very, very full. And that's why he's lying there. Well, like all cats, of course, they will sleep for a great deal of the time. And what I quite like about leopards is that even when they are lying on the ground like that, they still manage to maintain some sort of regal look about them. Whereas a lion, when he's lying on the ground, he's normally lying in a puddle of his own urine if he's had a kill, surrounded by his latrine. And there is nothing less regal than a lion at a kill after he's eaten. And yet the lion remains the king, and the leopard the humble prince. So, as I said, Maggie, I hope you enjoyed this leopard and that it eases your pain and your cat's pain. I hope she's watching too. So, Angela Pinto, you were watching the Djuma Dam cam yesterday evening, and on the Djuma Dam cam, a leopard appeared. Well, it looked almost like a cheetah, to be honest, but it was a leopard as far as I can tell. And you want to know if anyone found out who it was or when it was there? But no, no one did. I'm thinking it's Karula. It looked to me like Karula, just that was my kind of instinctual thought. That's her territory. Definitely a female, I think, not a male. And Mvula, who's the male territorial of the area, was found further south of Djuma this morning. So I think it was probably Karula. Who knows, though? That is a very difficult block. She's around there. She likes to go north out of there and into a block that's almost impossible to get a vehicle into. So I think it was probably Karula. It is very hot, of course, and that's why the leopard is not going to be doing a great deal at all. And I'm sure there are many of you who are very, very happy to see this fellow. I know I am. We will just sit here for a little bit. I don't want to move too much at the moment because he is going to, you know, he will move every so often. They tend to get quite uncomfortable lying in one position for too long. So although there are some leaves covering his face, I will move. Let's just sit for a little while and then I'll move and see if we can't get a better view. Question from Love Dogs, but on YouTube, again, an astonishing Twitter handle, good for you, Love Dogs, and you want to know what he's got, if it's nearby. I think it was, if I'm not mistaken, I think it was a baby impala, and I think it will probably be finished, unless he's got it stashed about here somewhere, but I don't think that whatever he killed is still around here now. And Love Dogs, quite interestingly, I mean, I don't know if this might be slightly distasteful to know, but of all the predators out here, the predators that will sort of attack or eat, you know, readily hunt other predators, the most are leopards. And so they'll eat jackals quite happily, they'll eat civets, try and take on honey badgers every so often. But they, you know, whereas some of the other predators tend to avoid that, they'll eat wild dogs if they can catch them. The leopard seems to more actively hunt other predators than many other of the predators out here. I'll just give you a sense of the atmosphere. It's quite sticky after the bit of morning rain that we had. So quite close, the atmosphere. The air is quite close. It's quite thick. It's hot, as I said. It's not that hot. It's probably about 32 degrees Celsius, which will put us at roughly 80 degrees Fahrenheit, which is quite pleasant. And no real smell of anything here. So I think very unlikely that the kill, whatever he ate, is still around. a wonderful comment from Sean in Secunda. You're going to come up to the Kruger next week, you say. That's a good time to be in the Kruger. And you say you've learned a huge amount from watching Safari Live and you can't wait to come and test yourself. Well, I think that's just wonderful. Thanks, Sean. You're, of course, most welcome. And we appreciate the time that you spend with us. I promise you, as much as you appreciate spending the time with us. So I think we'll probably spend most of the afternoon sitting here with him. I don't suspect he's going to get up and do anything particularly action-packed, but he is a magnificent fellow, so we'll sit here for a while with him. And just to reiterate, if you do happen to be a new viewer, you are welcome to ask us anything you like, well, within reason, of course, about the animals that we're seeing. And just remember, there are no stupid questions. There are plenty of stupid answers, many of which I've given by mistake. But if you want to know, you might be a first-time viewer who's never seen a cat like this before. You might even know what it is. Please feel free to ask us anything you like. Great. That bush is just in the wrong place, I'm afraid, and I can't get round it because there's a huge stump in front of me. Yeah, we're just going to have to put up with him through the bushes. Now, one of the questions, of course, people ask very often is how close do we get and how is it possible that we're able to get so close? See, as you can see, he's not comfortable. He'll keep switching around. We're sitting roughly 15 meters from, no, 10 meters from him, 33 feet or so. And he's not even paying us the slightest bit of attention. A lot of people mistake that for some kind of sort of tame, like the animal is tame. He's not tame at all. If we got out of the vehicle, he would react immediately. Probably disappear off into the drainage line. If he was cornered, then he might push home and attack. Neither of which we really want, but you'll find that they become so used to the vehicles that you can drive up and down around them without affecting their behavior at all. And that, of course, is the most magnificent thing out here, because we can watch them behave completely naturally while they just ignore us. And that's the way to really learn about animals, to be around them for extended periods without actually affecting their behavior. He's exhausted. The beautiful golden color on his back. Isn't that lovely? Now, Tingana, interestingly, comes from the far, far south of the Sabi Sands. Most of the other males of this area come from close by. You say this is your first time seeing Tingana. Well, I'm so glad we've got to show him to you. He's right on the western fringes of our traversing area, so I think we're quite lucky to have found him here. And I don't want you to think that I tracked and found him, because I didn't. I was told where he was, so that's how we're here. Eric, yes, a wonderful early Christmas present for you, and I hope that you will see him quite a lot more over the coming months, and some of the other male leopards that we have knocking about the place. Now, all the way from Munich, I'm not sure that you've spoken to us before, Katja. If you have, I apologize. This is your first time, good on you, and thank you for your time and for taking the time out to ask us a question. You want to know if leopards will hunt animals out of trees. Katja, the short answer is no, they won't. The long answer is they might, perhaps if conditions were absolutely perfect. I have seen it happened once on a documentary, and I wonder if you haven't seen that documentary, where a male leopard leaps out of a tree onto an impala ram. Now, I subsequently heard that shot was set up. So they knew where the leopard was, and they herded the impala ram towards the tree. and then the leopard jumped out of it. I've certainly never seen it. I don't know anybody who has seen it. I don't see why it shouldn't be possible. But you'll find that animals are very vigilant about what's in the trees, and leopards, you know, they seldom actually hide deep in the foliage of trees. And if they are deep in the foliage, it's quite a risk to leap out of a tree onto an animal rather than to stalk it. So that's the long answer, Katya. I'd say it's highly unlikely, certainly not impossible. You seem to have moved around a bit for your Christmas holidays. You're in Denmark at the moment. I hope you've got a very warm jacket to wear there. Mr. Moustache, you want to know how much a leopard will eat in one sitting, a big male leopard like this? Well, he probably weighs roughly 70 to 75 kilograms. I don't think, you know, he's not particularly enormous, so I'd say the Anderson male probably weighs about 90 kilos, 85 to 90, so I'd put him at about 75 or so. In one sitting, he'll probably eat up to 20% of his body mass. So 20% of 75, good grief, that's a difficult thing to work out. No, it's not. It's 15 kilograms. 15 kilograms of meat, and if you're working in pounds, the logic of which escapes me, then you are looking at about 40 pounds, Mr. Moustache. That's quite a lot of meat. 40 pounds of meat in one sitting is an obscene meal. They have to do that because, of course, they will then go days without eating. All right, we're going to sit here with this currently flat cat. Let's head across to Brent. He's got a herd of elephants to show you, and we'll wait right here, and I'll keep you posted if he does anything. See you just.
So we've caught up with a breeding herd of ellies, and they're heading towards what could be a very fascinating place. They're not there yet, but they could be in about half an hour or so. So I'm going to stick with them. They have started digging for underground water at the treehouse waterhole. And I was out tracking the other day and I saw them digging in the mud, and they've actually managed to get some water out of it. So it could be really interesting if this group makes it up there. They're not too far now. And with this drought and lack of water, elephants become incredibly important. They do manage to dig up the sort of low-lying underground water, or they could be lazy and head towards the Djuma pan. We shall see shortly. Zoom in on the eyes, you see how long her eyelashes are. And you can see the ears flapping a lot. It's hot. Elephants are able to pump about 8 liters of blood into their ears, and you can see some of the veins, even on the front side, are sticking out today. And what they're doing is they cool that blood by flapping and then send it through to the rest of their body. 8 liters is just under 2 gallons of blood in their ears at a time. Ellies have been, we start moving big distances at this time of the year, especially with the drought between water and food. And a massive animal like this has to eat and drink an incredible amount. And a female like this in front of us probably eats 400 pounds of vegetable matter in a day. And drinks. Now my maths has failed me. But drinks about up to about 100 liters of water. I was trying to work that out in gallons. 4.5 liters is 1 gallon. About 20, just over 20 gallons of water a day. And this is incredible. That elephant is probably 7 feet from us, 8 feet from us. And totally unperturbed with our presence. Feeding on grass. Seems like lots of people quite happy to have the Ellies here. Smart Redhead says we've made her day, and Pamela said all she wants for Christmas is an elephant. Well, hopefully we'll be able to produce elephant on Christmas as well as today. So, Pamela, early Christmas present for you. Busy feeding off a buffalo thorn at the moment. One of the few evergreen tree species we get in this area. A very important food source for a lot of animals throughout the year. We've been chatting about how dry it is. We've had very little rain and doesn't look like it's about to change. And Karen, who's in the Big Smoke or London, the UK, is saying, aren't we worried about the underground water table? As far as I know, Karen, it is still A-OK. And no need to worry just yet. At one of the biggest land mammal in the world. And Smart Redhead said her parents went on safari to Kenya and were told that the elephant is the king, so to speak, and she would like to know, is this regional or is it throughout Africa? So there's that whole myth that the lion is the king of the beasts. By no means the most dominant species out here is the elephant, and I think that's what they're referring to there. So the true sort of king of the bush is the elephant, being much bigger and stronger than anyone else, and lions will generally run from them. So we've got a few little ones coming out, and a female, some really nice long tusks, big female as well. Isn't this just the most wonderful scene? And here comes a naughty little boy at the back. And it looks like he belongs to that tall, long-tusked female. And you see, when there is a little bit of grass around, elephants we'll try to eat as much grass as possible. It's very high in starches. So we're going to stay with these Ellies, but while we do that, let's go have a look at the Christmas elf and his leopard.
And there Tingana has picked his head up, magnificent leopard that he is, And one of the things, of course, that a lot of people who've never seen a male leopard before don't know the difference between a male and a female, well, other than the obvious, which you can see. First of all, a male is much bigger than a female. He's much thicker set. He's got a much bigger head. His neck is thicker, and that's because he, well, exhausted. He engages in a bit more fighting than the females do, and of course, testosterone, as we know, will build muscle mass. There he is, breathing very heavily. So the most noticeable difference between a male and a female is the size. Eric Moore, a very good question from you, and you obviously know a bit about the animals of this area. You want to know if elephants scavenge, not elephants, if leopards scavenge, or if they only eat live prey. Elephants don't scavenge. Leopards are good scavengers, yes. Not nearly as good as hyenas and lions, but if they can steal a kill from, say, wild dogs, or steal a piece of lion kill, or steal from a hyena or a cheetah, absolutely they will do that. They're not, I mean, in terms of the freshness of the meat, they're very happy to eat pretty rancid, rotten stuff. But normally, you know, because of the way they're set up, you know, they are solitary, so they don't want to fight over kills. They will try and avoid conflict at all costs. So unless they can steal something without being hurt and without a physical confrontation, they won't steal. And so in areas where there are no lions and no hyenas, they are much more likely to scavenge than they would be in an area like this. So although they are immensely powerful, they will avoid conflict because they are solitary. And if they get hurt, they won't eat. Now, in terms of their diet, of course, they will, like I say, they will scavenge a bit. And in this area, their main food would be impala and probably small antelope like steenbok and duiker. And Wayne, you say you've heard that they will eat just about anything. Leopards do eat just about anything. They have what we term a very Catholic diet, and that just means it's very wide. They'll eat just about anything at all, and of course that's why they are so widely distributed, the most widely distributed of all the big cats. And I mean, the same species extends, it's a different subspecies, but same species extends all the way into the far east of Russia. It goes into China, it goes of course into Arabia, and was once India, was once found all over Europe, well, probably in the southern reaches of Europe. And yes, Wayne, they will eat anything from insects to lizards to reptiles, other reptiles to squirrels, mongoose, other predators, large antelope, the records of them killing adult male kudu. So, I mean, they have a huge range of things that they can eat. They even fish. They'll hit catfish out of water and eat those. So, yeah, Wayne, they'll eat anything. It's one of the reasons they're so widely distributed. Yeah, you can hear the other kingfisher, the woodland kingfisher. And I can actually hear that. I can hear that grey-headed kingfisher going brrr, 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 off in the distance. That's not him. That's the woodland. And then, Randall, just to get back to your question, just to sort of round it off there. You want to know why they're called kingfishers? They're called kingfishers because many examples of kingfishers do catch fish. Now, they hover above the water, leap down into it, and then pull fish out, or they hunt from a perch like the giant kingfisher. So the giant kingfisher, the pied kingfisher, the malachite kingfisher, there's another one too, but its name escapes me briefly. The pygmy doesn't eat fish. The pygmy is not much of a fish eater, nor is the woodland kingfisher, nor is the brown-hooded kingfisher, nor indeed is the grey-headed kingfisher, although the grey-headed apparently will eat fish and frogs. So those three, malachite, pied, and giant, definitely eat fish. I'm definitely leaving one of the fish eaters out. Get my book out. listener all the way from YouTube, RJM. You want to know why he's breathing so heavily? He's breathing so heavily, one, because it's hot, and two, because his big fat belly is pushing up against his lungs, which means he cannot expand his chest cavity in the way that he would like to, and so he's having to breathe much more shallowly than he would. And what that does is that it oxygenates the blood apparently around the stomach very nicely, and it helps him to digest that meat as fast as possible, so that if he had more meat he could ingest more as quick as possible, and also so that his belly doesn't become a hindrance if he needs to get away from something quickly. Gracie aged 8 says maybe he's getting fat so that he can be Santa in a few days' time for all of us here in the bush. Gracie, he may well be doing that. He may be the Santa of the bush. I think he's going to need a bit of a beard for that first, though. But it is well possible, Gracie. And you say you hope that Santa brings us all lots of fun things, candy and toys. I hope I get a toy from Santa as well. I'm getting very tired of getting adult presents. And not nearly as exciting as when you're a little one and you get these magnificent things to play with. I think somebody gave me socks once for Christmas. I immediately stopped speaking to them. Now, Brent was talking a little bit about digging for water, I think, and he certainly discovered at the treehouse dam that the elephants have reached water, and I'm sure he told you about that. And Ramey, you want to know if the whole of the Kruger Park is suffering from this drought. Ramey, I'm not convinced, as some are, that we are in the throes of a massive drought. Yes, it is dry. Yes, it is drier than it would be normally at this time of the year. I don't think the animals are having an enormous suffer at the moment, so I don't think it's a train smash yet. It may get to that stage. But the whole Kruger Park is in the same position, yes, absolutely. Nowhere has they had. It's because last year was also a below average rainfall year, and that means that the double effect of the late rains this year will be very keenly felt. The groundwater will be shallower than it is normally. These areas like this clearing, where there are grass seeds waiting dormant in the soil, they won't sprout if there isn't sufficient rain, and so these sorts of areas will become drier. You'll start to notice a drought at the end of the so-called wet season. That's when we'll start to feel it. I don't believe that the animals are suffering at the moment. And so, yes, while it is drier in the Kruger than it is normally, certainly I think if we were farming, it would be a nightmare, and certainly many of the farmers in the country are having a really rough time at the moment because the rains have been so late. But in this particular area, because it's a natural area, the ecology, like I say, the animals and the plants and all the other bits and pieces that make up this ecosystem are quite used to having droughts every so often. And so, yes, there will be some die-off, I'm sure, if the drought lasts, but the ecosystem itself will remain completely intact. Hello, Jonesy on Twitter. You're joining us for the first time, and you say it's very compelling viewing. Well, I hope that we maintain your compulsion to watch. Certainly, we find it very compelling working here, and I'm so glad you've joined us, and thank you for sending through a question for the first time. It's great to hear from you. I'm just going to quickly show you these other kingfishers. Now, Timsy, if we can have a look here. There were two that I forgot that eat fish. One is the mangrove kingfisher, which of course doesn't occur here, owing to the fact that there are no mangroves in the Kruger National Park, which is unsurprising. It looks almost identical to a woodland kingfisher, but not quite the same. It doesn't have the black underbeak like that. There's the grey-headed. He doesn't eat any fish. They will eat... It says occasionally catches fish, like I said, so they will eat some fish. Then these chaps. There's the brown hooded, we get him here, he doesn't catch fish. There's the striped, he doesn't catch fish. There's the pygmy, he doesn't catch fish. Then we get the half-collared, which is a fish color catcher. And the malachite kingfisher is also a fish catcher. So both of those catch. And just to reiterate, that's the very rare one that we saw earlier, the grey-headed kingfisher. And you can see also, these guys are called the halcyon kingfishers, and halcyon is the generic name, and a halcyon, if I'm not mistaken, is the color of blue that these kingfishers have on them, and that's why they're called the halcyon kingfishers. And the grey-headed has a very different halcyon kind of color compared with the others. Right, those are the kingfishers. Back to the leopard. Who is doing precisely what he was doing when we started looking at the kingfishers. He clearly finds kingfishers very boring indeed. They've put him into a deep sleep. Now, of course, I will always answer a question from the greatest Twitter handle that has ever been created, James Hendry's fan. You want to know why it is that lions live in prides and leopards do not, basically. What is the advantage to living in a pride? There's some debate over that. And I mean, the debate stems from the fact that a single lioness is probably as successful at hunting food as a, you know, as a group of two lionesses, and more so than a group of two lionesses, and probably the same success rate as three lionesses together. Over three, yes, they become more successful with the larger prey. So we don't think that it's evolved as a strategy to catch food, because they're highly competent hunters, exactly like the leopards, when they're on their own. So why else would they do it? Well, if you're not looking at food, then often you're looking at reproduction, and maybe there's a reason behind, you know, the pride structure helps with reproduction in some way. What it does do, because they're the apex predator, and I think they're, you know, their numbers are basically only kept down by other lions and a lack of prey, the incidence of sort of intra-specific competition and intra-specific conflict are probably higher than they are for some of the other animals. And we think this is maybe why they now live in pride. So it's for extra security, basically. It also apparently does... Look at him. You've got a domestic cat. That's exactly what you'll see with a domestic cat, of course. And while he looks very cute, you don't want to be going over there to give him a tickle, I promise you that. So, we think it's got the pride structure's got something to do with security. It helps them to beat off rivals that might come into their territories and then kill the cubs. And I think it also helps to protect cubs from infanticide, which of course in lions is a major thing. So that's a basic and not particularly comprehensive answer of why lions live in prides and why we think they live in prides. But it is the source of some debate, and it probably has a lot more to do with security for reproduction and for cubs than it has to do with hunting, although they are obviously very cooperative and highly successful cooperative hunters. And we get questions about how to age animals very often, and most often it's very difficult. And Eric, you want to know, with a leopard, can you tell the age of a leopard from its jowls, or the kind of hanging bits of skin below its head? No, the short answer is no, Eric, you can't. That said, if you look at a leopard like Mvula, who is 2.5 to 3 years older than Tingana, his face does look substantially more haggard. But, you know, I couldn't tell you whether that was always the case or whether it's just because he's getting a bit old now that he's got a bit of a haggard-looking face. The best way to age a leopard is from watching it and knowing it from birth. That's how we know exactly how old these leopards are. You can do it from body condition, and you can guess the age from body condition. So you know that a male leopard in this area will seldom live beyond 13 years. So if we look at Mvula, who's approaching his 12th birthday, he's starting to lose muscle mass on his hips. You can see his hips are starting to stick out. He's getting very jowly around the... His jowls are starting to look... they just look like an old man's jowls, basically. Whereas Tingana still got beautiful condition on his hips and his back legs. His hindquarters are in immaculate condition. He's in his prime still. But we can only tell his age because we know where he's from. We know, we know when he was born. With lions, it's a bit different. You can tell from their noses how old they are. Another query that's a very good one, and one that we do need to explain every so often, about why we don't see cheetah. And Monique in London, you want to know why we don't see cheetah. I think you've been on safari a few times. This habitat is not great for cheetah. So if I get Tebs to just pan around there to the left, that kind of woodland is the dominant vegetation type of this area, and the clearing that is behind where Tingana's lying is unusual. Were there to be a cheetah in this area, and there wasn't a leopard here, of course, and this is where the cheetah would be found, they have to have open areas to hunt in. They can't hunt through woodland like that. They're not stalkers, they're coursers, which means they chase down their prey, much like a wild dog does, but at twice the speed. You can't run through that at 60 miles an hour. You'll either bash your head or disembowel yourself on a stump. And that's a very real risk for cheetah. And that's one of the reasons they don't occur here. Apparently the high lion concentration in the Sabi Sands is also one of the reasons that they're not here. I think it's much more to do with habitat, though. Certainly in the open areas of Singita and Londolozi, where I used to work, we did see them every so often, much more frequently than we do up here in the north at Djuma. So I think it's got largely to do with habitat, Monique. They like that big open space so that they can run freely after their prey. In case you're wondering, Brentley S. Smith's managed to break his car again. He really is. He's quite something with that. And so that's why we're going to stay with Tingana. Luckily, we have this magnificent cat to look at while Brent tries to fix his picture. I'm being very unfair to the man. It's Rusty, and Rusty is a bit recalcitrant and just struggling to produce a picture at the moment. So we'll just stay with this lovely leopard for now. Hear the ring-necked dove calling in the background. And as many safari guides will tell you, at this time of the day it's saying drink lager, and in the morning it's saying work harder, work harder. Now, if you do have a safari guide tell you that, you must immediately be aware. Because if he then tells you the joke about the McDonald's of the bush when you see an impala, you must immediately ask for another safari guide. Because that joke has been told since probably 1746. Yes, he's not doing a great deal. What I want to do is just go around the corner here. There's another little pan of water, and let's just go and see if there isn't anything drinking there. And there's another one just down the road there. So we're going to go there, and then we'll come back to this area and see how Tingana is doing. Don't go anywhere, T-Dog.
Massachusetts. Thank you. You say you're enjoying the drive. That's great news. And you say Halcyon doesn't mean blue or a kind of blue. It means calm and peaceful, and that the kingfishers got their name from it. I mean, I know we talk about Halcyon days, which I suppose I've always thought of being sort of deep blue summer days, but there must be calm and peaceful days. So we talk about Halcyon days, and that's great information. Thank you very much for that, Brian. You say Aristotle used it to describe kingfishers, or one of his pals. Aristotle or one of his pals, one of his drinking buddies. And Deb, you watch the Pete's Pond feed from Mashatu in Botswana, and you want to know if we get pied kingfishers here. Deb, we do get pied kingfishers here, but they only occur over permanent water where they can hunt. And they're the kingfishers that hover like this above the water, and then they dive down and grab fish out of the air. Not out of the air, out of the fish don't fly. They grab fish out of the water. Here are these two old buffalo bulls. We'll just have a quick look at them and then go back to the leopard. Hello, Harvey Abbott. Harvey Abbott, I'm going to stop here and we can look at these buffalo quickly. Harvey Abbott, you say, what is this live stream about? Harvey Abbott, this live stream is about African wildlife and the magnificence thereof. We're sitting here in the northeastern part of South Africa and in the Kruger National Park, which is of course an iconic national park of the world, twice or three times the size of Yellowstone National Park. And we're sitting here on two sort of western fringes of that, on two game reserves called Djuma and Arathusa, about 4,000 acres of land that we traverse, and you're on a live game drive. You're on the largest game drive in the world, largest safari in the world. And we're watching some buffalo now, two buffalo bulls lying in some water, completely live. Well, they're obviously alive, and you are live with us. And they're chewing the cud, and it's live and interactive, so please do talk to us as you are now. And ask us any questions you have, send us any comments. It's great to have you on board. Two lovely buffalo bulls, very peaceful afternoon this, especially with the only predator in the area so full of food. Explanation that we have to give every so often. Paul, you want to know why we don't see rhinos on these drives, and you want to know if there are any here, and it dovetails quite nicely with a comment from Jeffrey in Texas, who says the US has just poured, he's just sent through a link, the US has just poured millions of dollars into the protection of white rhinos, all rhinos in fact. Paul, we don't show rhino. They do occur in this area. We don't show them because we don't want anybody with nefarious intentions watching the show to know where they are. You know, whether or not that makes a difference, we don't know, but certainly we don't want to negatively affect the rhinos at all. In the Sabi Sands, they've almost got the situation under control. I think they have more or less stopped the poaching. There have been a few incidents this year, but that's basically why we don't show rhino. And I'm very glad and grateful that there are people in the US pouring millions of dollars into the conservation of rhinos. It's a very complicated and difficult problem to deal with. Let's head back across to Brent. He seems to have managed to fix his car, and we'll head back towards Tingana now.
Be great over the sea tracks. So Scott found some more wild dog tracks. He's out tracking. So he's in the bush behind me here, and just decided to come check if they've crossed this road junction. looking carefully into the deep shade. See if they're resting about here somewhere. So a very, very astute observation by safari guides, who wonders whether some guides prefer the thrill of tracking to actually spotting them. And you will find quite a few of us do prefer to track and then see an animal rather than to just bump into them. It feels like you haven't worked for it. Are you looking in the shade?
Yes.
Come on. Oh, dogs. So we have a misplaced South African called Fiona, who's living in the UK. And Fiona's wondering, where does the term game come from when referring to wild animals? Fiona, that is an excellent question that I have absolutely no idea. Maybe we should ask James, maybe he's got an idea. The only way I can think of it comes from hunting. Big game, it's a game, hunting big game would be my guess, but I'm not 100% sure. Checking all the nice spots of shade. Very carefully, yeah. Andrew, make yourself useful. Spot a wild.